So we've been listening to a lot of issues over the last couple of sessions, and including yesterday and today. And probably what I'm going to speak to you today is probably going to be sound like a summary of what was spoken, right? That's because many of the issues that I picked for talking today about the ethics of the internet are somewhat connected to the issues raised, and they kind of bring it together from a different perspective, from, let's say, a philosophical perspective. Right, when we talk about ethics, we're talking about choices, we're talking about right and wrong, and I don't want to go into a philosophical history of ethics, etc. But I want to take an alternate view of ethics. Ethics is usually considered as a choice between right and wrong. But when I was working on for class on teaching Indian ethics, I came across a couple of instances where ethics is not about right and wrong, but ethics is also about moral dilemmas. Let me illustrate from our own example of the internet what I mean by a moral dilemma and a moral choice. A moral choice is, can I steal somebody else's laptop, yes or no? And it's very clear, it's not legal, in the sense it's not about law, it's about how we respond to a situation and say this is correct, this is wrong. This is morally, ethically, unethical for me to steal because it's somebody else's property. Whatever reason, we may give a reason, we may have a consequence for it. There are names, philosophical names like deontological ethics, consequential ethics, utilitarian ethics. So there are all these philosophical schools that have different theories about ethics. But what we also have is the moral dilemma. Let's say my company holds me back at 5 o'clock and asks me to work after my hours, and I'm really feeling tired, I've worked on a lot of meetings, and I'm sitting in my room in the office, supposed to be doing my work, and I decide to surf the internet. And I find a site that is playing Scrabble games, and I start playing Scrabble. I'm sitting in my office, supposed to do my work, and now I have a choice before me. And this is not a choice. It's not, now if you look at it, it's not so anymore so simple. It's not right, oh, you're in the office, so you must work. No, because the office is holding me back after hours, that's wrong. Or is it wrong for me to be doing Scrabble inside the... So unless you've thought over and decided this is what I will do, this is my principle, I'll not do personal work in office. For a normal person, this is a dilemma. And a dilemma is about layers. A dilemma is about you as a human being, you're not one rational, one-pointed thinking entity, but you are a layer of psychological entities. In India, we would call it dharmas, right? You have different kinds of duties towards different people, and when two duties conflict, you have a moral dilemma, not a moral choice. So are you going to be a son or a citizen of India? Are you going to be a good nursemaid and save the prince by giving your own child? Are you going to be a mother and protect your child and forget about patriotism to your king? So all these are called moral dilemmas. And most of the time, our ethics is not about, you know, so when we talk about ethics, like, I don't see pornography, so I think that's unethical to see pornography, so I'm okay. So the point is, most normal people, most ordinary everyday people are faced with moral dilemmas, and not exactly like, you know, straight moral choices and something like doing very, very much evil and very much good. So we have to first remember that when we're talking about human and the internet and the network society, we are no longer dealing in such simple definitions of ethics as be honest, or, you know, the kind of stories that we read when we were in our younger classes. So we have to look at the complexities, and sometimes I think the whole ethics is about thinking through the ethics. To be ethical is to think and to be uncomfortable. And I think most of the time we are not ethical beings or not thinking ethically because we are uncomfortable about reflection, about thinking. And as we know in social research and people who are involved in humanities, it's always a difficult life. As Sam put it so succinctly, we are all messed up all the time because we have to think a lot before we do anything, before we make these choices. So, like sometimes my brother says, "Bas khareed dalo ya, just buy the stuff. Why are you thinking so much about it?" So that is because we are reflective beings, and thinking through a problem or thinking through an action, it makes us ethical beings. So as ethical beings, I think the first step is to start reflecting and thinking through the problems rather than making these decisions based on certain kinds of sways or populism or being popular. Or even to be popular, you have to think, do I want to be popular? And, you know, it's always a reflective thing. And it's a very uncomfortable space to be in if you want to be an ethical person. Thinking always involves energy, and most people prefer not to think and go with the crowd or go with whatever they desire or in instant gratification. So, therefore, when humans are so layered, yesterday we heard about this new space that we occupy called the virtual space, and this virtual space is a mesospace. So, thinking a little about who you are on the virtual space. Okay, and why do and thinking about who you are when you are on the internet, that we could call is sort of an area of ethics, which is about an individual. How does an individual become an ethical agent or act as an ethical agent inside the virtual space? And I think the rules for being a good human being in the actual space and a good human being in the virtual space are more or less same. You don't. If you're bullying here, you bully there. If you are patriarchal and irritating, you can be patriarchal and irritating on the web. If you are fraudulent, you can be fraudulent. So more or less, the ethics of individual behavior inside cyberspace, except for the fact that maybe you get more opportunity because of anonymity or the types of crimes you can commit on the internet or the types of punishments that you can be the way you can be discovered on the internet are different. Basically, a good ethical human being in the real world and a good ethical human being on the internet are more or less good ethical human beings. And those who want to be non-ethical are non-ethical, can be non-ethical both. Sometimes there be people, because of the pleasure of anonymity, they can be more unethical online, and they think they cannot be discovered. But as the last lecture pointed out, it may be possible for people to find you out more faster if you're on the internet. As far as I can recall, all the recent developments of finding these terror people and all happened because they went to a cyber cafe. If it didn't go and they used, you know, pigeon carriers or something, they might have not been discovered. But it seems like it's not, anonymity is not a question anymore, since the same people who survey us for our emails and our advertising products can also survey us for our unethical acts on the internet. So I want to pull you away from this normal discussion of ethics into another area of ethics. I want to ask the question. We're talking about the network society, we're talking about sharing and flow of knowledges. When you're talking about flow of knowledges, we can ask three main questions in this, which is the questions we ask as social science researchers and humanities scholars. Who is a knower? You know, we say knowledge is being produced, who is the consumer or who is the knower? And then we say, where is the information? Where is the information that this knower, or where is the knowledge that this knower produces? And then we ask, what is the source of this information? So there's some knowledge that's being produced, there's a knower who's knowing that information, and there's some source of this information. And within that, we can say that there is already an epistemic divide, as it were, between these three categories. And when you're looking at the epistemic categories, epistemic divides, we already have come up with three different issues that I flag here. One is the difference between the internet and the real world in terms of production of knowledge. I've been hearing this whole virtual world idea, that somewhere somebody sitting in a computer can produce this bit of Wikipedia or knowledge that is now instantly multicasted to the world and everybody consumes it. And the assumption is that this is airdropped, to use again an internet word, it's airdropped from somewhere and we are consuming this information and we're saying, hey, we are more informed, we are better informed. But where is the geographic, what we tend to forget is that person sitting in the computer in front of a screen is a real embodied person. Definitely till today, even in the metaphysical books which I've read, ghosts do not produce this knowledge. Nor do peoples from another dimension. Hopefully we don't know about them if they are. But these knowledges are coming from a real person sitting in a real body in front of a real computer screen and producing real knowledge from his act of thinking. And therefore these pieces of information that we are consuming, the knowledge is not coming from some disembodied source, but it's coming from a geographically located real material space. And since almost, it's very clear from earlier theories of knowledge that most knowledge is culturally and geographically produced, and it has certain kinds of implications to what knowledge is produced where and for what it is produced and how it is produced and transmitted. Even whether it be language, whether it be the metaphors used in the language, whether it be the purpose of the language. So knowledge in the virtual world is not virtual. Knowledge, the source of knowledge is still geographical. So whether we, let me talk a little bit about my pet peeve, the knowledge that is accessible to an Indian student maybe, you know, the kind of peer review that goes through our academic work. I mean, the question is, why don't we publish, you know? And every time we try to publish, always I find out that my American counterparts or even my Indian friends who are in Europe or Berlin have more access to the kind of knowledge and the information flow. And the action, and not only that, if I produce some piece of knowledge or some piece of paper which is totally dependent on, let's say, India-related sources, it's more likely that I will not be accepted by the international community, aka the Western community or the Eurocentric community. So knowledge that is produced from within India is sometimes consumed by Indian centers. And here, again, there's a difference in the epistemic divide. Where are these centers of knowledge in India that are producing these sources of knowledge? Is it like an urban-rural divide? I don't know, but I'm likely to say that the geographical boundaries are not considered when we think of a borderless world, a world that doesn't have any real materiality. But the truth is, if I have open software and I put out a knowledge piece in a document and it goes to a person who has a Microsoft or an Apple, obviously all the formatting is going to get spoiled and he's going to think, oh, what bad editing. Right? So he's going to say something about the origin of the knowledge. So it's not that these things are immaterial and floating around in some cyberspace or some ghost-like place where everything is all right and everything is borderless. So I wanted to think about the ethics of place. I wanted to think about the ethics of geographical movement of knowledge, the sources of knowledge, the cultural and the geographical divides of a so-called seamless world. The other thing that I also want you to remember is that just like we construct our, I don't believe that the social reality is a given. I think we construct our social reality, whether it is IT for Change and Manipal Center or something, there's been a process of constructing this conference. And so it's a social reality that is constructed. It has human agency. It just didn't happen. Social realities are constructed in certain times and spaces and contexts and historical narratives within those discourses. And if this social reality is constructed, it cannot be denied that the virtual world is a further step away and it's an even more constructed reality. The question of authenticity inside a virtual world is something we have to think about. Is how much of the social reality that we take for given or granted inside the virtual world is actually constructed, or is it constructed from a group of people, or is there one programmer who's sitting and making what we call the environment of the virtual world? So is it just a programmer? You know, so many times I've wondered why a particular website, like I picked up something from, I never knew there was clutter in a website. I mean, it didn't occur to me. I've always been dealing with clutter in the house and clutter in my box, clutter in my office room. But I never thought of clutter on the thing. So if Kiran feels that is cluttered, another person feels that is not cluttered. So what kind of agency determines the kind of spaces in which these knowledges are shared? So that is also an ethical question we have to ask, and definitely the choices become not only ethical, of course political, but also ethical in some sense of the word. The other point that I wanted to flag was the idea of difference between the ethics of, in some sense here I'm moving on to the topic of justice and equality, where we can ask the question that there is already a divide in many disciplines between what we call the expert view and the layman's view. The expert view is somebody who's in control, who's a Spider-Man of the web, and who knows where he's going and where he's coming. And so there's a kind of a divide, maybe not so much in terms of the usage itself, but in terms of the attitude of people who think that the expert are the geeks and the non-experts are the lay people. The experts become the producers, the lay people are the users. So the producers tell the users what to do all the time. It is like a moral superiority that the experts have certain access to certain kinds of control. Therefore, they are more equal than the other people who use the net. And this is very true because I'm going to bring in the question of the gender here. It's very true because I've seen personally that a lot of spaces where there is access to an internet or a mobile or anything, it is the male members of a family or a community that take charge of so-called technical things. It's as if you are not a geek, you won't understand this, you can't handle this, this is something meant for the men. There's this, all these conversations that are going on behind, which makes it a very unjust space for women to interact with technology. In fact, I was very happy when somebody suggested that I'm going to give the mobile phones to the people and form the network. But even then, when something goes wrong, the whole point is, oh, you're a woman, you may not be okay with technology, you cannot handle that. So personal experience too. It took some convincing my family that I could handle something called the iPad, which is, or a washing machine or whatever. So so as George remarked, when you talk about the internet person, there are various subjectivities involved. Then I'm going to move on to another area in this expert versus layman. One of the ways in which the control or the psychological control of these spaces occurs is through the ethics of fear. I did circulate a paper on it. I feel that the whole, there are two ways in which there are these unjust spaces are created in the internet. One of it is there are three kinds of fear that government control, right? Where you say, beware. If you don't take the Aadhaar card, you will not get this. If you don't log on and be a part of this community, if you don't have a university email ID, you won't get the mails from the university. So there's a threat and there's a hidden fear that if I don't do, then what? And this fear psychosis captures the imagination of most people, and most people, and therefore what happens is there's this fear created which gives, it becomes unjust because somebody else who's producing this fear, it's a form of terrorism, but it's, we cannot call it terrorism because terrorism has other implications, but it's creating a fear psychosis inside you. The second thing is, how, for example, in a village in Tamil Nadu, they were told if they didn't have mobile phones, a young lady came up to me and said, if I don't have a mobile phone, how will I know the tsunami is coming? So it's that level. If you don't have a mobile phone, you won't know tsunami is coming, and if you don't know tsunami is coming, then you will be, I won't tell her that, You may not even read those messages, you may not even know. When the tsunami hits, you may have to run for your life without, but that's the fear psychosis that's created, and therefore you have to have a mobile phone. So that these are some of the ways in which the ethics of fear operates, like how do you counter that, or how do you look at that? And the other one is the legal illegal part, right? Where Usha has been talking a lot about that, but the idea of buy the original Microsoft Office version. Don't buy the pirated. Don't download books. Don't keep Xerox copies in your library. So there's this whole knowledge is just trapped inside the legal, illegal frameworks, which are again, where again we can question the social justice of that. Where when we talk about information being free, we need to take a step back and say, is it really free? Is it really open? Is it so easy to access all that we want, all that where we want? The other issue is, one is like trust issues, where there is a deep suspicion of technology. On one hand, there is a danger of wanting technology. On the other hand, there's a deep suspicion of technology, technophobia. And this comes from certain kinds of ideas. Sometimes the technology is very evil, where people who should be thinking about it reject it completely, don't even find out what it is, and then it becomes a problem. On the other hand, the other trust issue is that there are values such as efficiency, relationship, getting things faster, saving time. These kind of values are attributed to technology and not to the agent. So if I am able to cook my dinner or something in 20 minutes, it's not I who have cooked the dinner, it's my microwave and my gas and my pressure cooker and my whatever iPad recipe and whoever internet coach and everyone who has been responsible for it. So to a certain extent, the value riders on technology reverse the position of giving certain kinds of values to technology. and removing the agent from the operation of the technology. It's like, I'm sorry, I might write a nasty mail and I didn't mean to send it, but I clicked the send button. There's, so it's like a kind of a ethical divide. It's like whatever happens on the internet, I'm not responsible for it, it just happened. So those kind of divides between technology and the agent happen. And finally, the whole idea of the innocence of technology, which we've been talking about, that it's just a tool. And these are ways in which we tend to, I think, move away from the actual concern and stop getting our hands dirty by saying, oh, there was this gun, and it's when we say, petrol khatam ho gaya. Actually, you didn't fill the petrol, but then you will say, petrol khatam ho gaya. It's a way of avoiding responsibility, avoiding stakeholdership, avoiding standing in for some principle ethical value. To kind of take another 2 minutes more, that's all. Then I would also bring in about the whole idea of choices. When I'm talking about situated knowledges and geographical knowledges, looking at it from a feminist standpoint theory, one would say the idea of producer and consumer of choices is like a false choice of autonomy and anonymity. Because already, as we have heard from Nikhil, the way the records are based are all management-based. There are certain kinds of rules and regulations or certain kinds of power relationships in managing this information that you're accessing. So where you go and where you surf and how you go, which pathway you follow, is already predetermined by certain people who have the power. So it's not like you're freely surfing the web. You're actually being led into various things. And most of the time, like Hansel and Gretel, you're going into this witch's den and you don't know you're going. And so one of the ways, the implication of this is, where are you standing in when you're looking at these things, and where are those people standing in when they're producing the knowledge and making you surf? And finally, my most favorite thing is the whole language. We are referring to internet as a world. We're calling it a world. We're calling it a place. We're calling it a space. We did not call the post office or the letter as a postal world. We did not call the telephone as a telephone world. We still don't call the mobile as a mobile world. But we do call the internet as a virtual world. And what does it imply for us to occupy two worlds at the same time? What are the ethics? What happens when we use place as a metaphor? Once you have place, you have passports, you have boundaries. You have controls, you have citizenships, you have capitals, you have economies. And that's what is happening because we are inhabiting a second world. And so I think the whole problem is if we call it a world, all these controls that apply in the real world start applying in the virtual world. So that's why probably you're having like virtual world marriages and virtual world money and virtual world avatars. You know, it's the whole language of speaking itself raises so many ethical questions. And because metaphors are not innocent, metaphors are problematic. Just because you call something something, the whole perspective of it can change. And for people who are in the village, they still don't call it an internet. For them, it's like a radio. So it's like something in which all the information is there. So they still don't inhabit. But the way the urban, I'm sure studies will show that the way they relate to the internet as a box with information will be like a book or some Gram Panchayat records. But the way we will relate to it is, it's my world. So what does it imply for us to give agency, give reality to that world and impose a reality on ourselves in this world? So it is not that the virtual and the real lines are blurring by themselves. We are blurring these real lines. And what does it mean for us as agents, as ethical agents, to blur these lines? So these are some of the questions. I flagged a number of issues. I'm sure there's lots of debate and questions possible. But I think at least some of this would encourage you to think a little more about the space of ethics and justice in the internet-mediated world. Thank you.